All right, so I didn't forget the song of preparation. We are going to sing it, but first I want to get us all on the same page, okay? Because we just started a new sermon series last week called Tried and True. And it is, we are highlighting four different hymns or songs that we sing frequently as the people of God. And as you know, when we do things over and over again, sometimes we are not paying all that much attention to the words that we're singing, so that we are not making the most of this tool that God has given us to worship Him. So last Monday night, we had our trustee meeting, and in all of our meetings around here, we always start our meetings by going around the table and asking for a one-word check-in. And we got to Brad Gamble, and Brad Gamble's answer to the question, "How are you doing today?" was, "I'm better than I deserve. I'm better than I deserve." And I thought, this was Monday, I thought this fellow was really listening to the sermon yesterday, because it was all about Amazing Grace. We started with John Newton's hymn, Amazing Grace. And if we are aware of the fact that God had transferred our souls from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of eternal light, then we are all better than we deserve. Amen? Amen. So I'm reading this book called Recovered by Robbie Gallaty, and I don't want to run away too fast from this notion of that there is saving grace that God gives us, but there is also daily grace that He gives us. So listen to these words that Robbie put in his book. He grew up in a Christian family in an affluent home, and he was in a car accident, and it turned out that he became addicted to pain medication, to opioids, and he ended up buying and selling drugs and went into the deepest, darkest pit that you can imagine. And it took several years and a lot of relapses, and he finally took hold of Jesus' hand and let Jesus drag him out of this miry pit. And this is what he writes. "Addictive impulses are forever, whether it's drugs, drink, or plain old disobedience to God. The addiction is primarily sin, not drugs. And the old Robbie still isn't dead. This is a mystery the Bible teaches us. In one sense, when we are saved, we're totally saved. We're completely free from the punishment that we deserve for our sin. And the Bible even says we're free from the power of sin. We don't have to keep on sinning. The old self was crucified with Christ, God's word tells us. But even though the old self is crucified with Christ, we're told to put the old self to death. So the old self dies with Christ on the cross, but he keeps trying to get back up day after day, and God calls us to put him to death. That old self will hang around until Jesus returns or calls us home. On that day, we will be free from the power, penalty, and even the presence of sin. But until then, we're all recovering sin addicts, being called day after day to put the old self to death." That's why we need God's saving grace, and we need God's daily grace. And I say thanks be to God that His grace is amazingly sufficient for you and for me. Let's pray. Good and gracious God, you are so faithful to teach us and guide us so that we can grow as your children. May our ears and our hearts be open. May our souls be soothed as we hear your words of life and truth today. To you be the glory, Father, forever and ever. Amen. So today we're going to learn about the author of the hymn, the lyrics that we sing when we sing, "It Is Well With My Soul." The words were written by Horatio Spafford in 1873, and then the tune was written by Philip Bliss, and the hymn, as we now are about to sing it, was published in 1876. Let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. The author of the lyrics that we just sang together, Horatio Gates Spafford, was a Christian and he was an elder in the Presbyterian Church in Chicago. He was a lawyer who, though previously very successful, had suffered significant setbacks during the Great Chicago Fire of 1871. He had a lot of real estate investments that he lost. And then his finances took another hit in what was called the Panic of 1873 financial crisis. So after two really rough years, he decided to try to alleviate some of his family's pain by taking them on a vacation to Europe. So the great preacher and revivalist from Chicago, D.L. Moody, was a friend of the Spaffords, and he was over in Europe preaching at the time. And Horatio thought it would be encouraging to his family to go over there and to witness some of the revivals that were going on that Moody was preaching. So the plans were made for the family, which included Horatio and his wife Anna and their four daughters, Annie, Margaret, Elizabeth, and Tanetta, to set sail on November 15th on a French iron steamship called the Vie du Havre. They all went to New York to begin their trip, and as it turns out, at the last minute, Horatio was called back on a business deal of some sort, and he wasn't able to go, but he went ahead and sent his family ahead on the ship and said that he would join them as soon as possible. It was a week into the voyage at 2 a.m., on November 22nd, 1873, that the ocean liner they were on collided with the British clipper, the Loch Erne. And even as the ship was struck, and it sounded like an explosion, some of the survivors said, the captain was saying, "It's nothing, it's nothing." Well, it was something. The ship took on water and it ended up sinking in 12 minutes, killing 226 people, including all four of the Spafford's daughters. The mother, Anna, was found unconscious, clinging to a floating plank in the ocean. There was a rescue ship that came and took the survivors to Cardiff, Wales. And once Anna arrived there, she sent a telegram to her husband in Chicago that included these words, "Saved alone." Horatio left Chicago to go to meet Anna immediately. And at one point during the voyage, the captain, who knew his story, invited him to come where he was into the cabin. And he said that they had determined pretty much the exact spot where the ship had gone down, where his daughters had died. And he said they were in that moment just going over that area. And Horatio went back to his cabin, and as a result of that and his immovable and very strong faith in the Lord, that's when he wrote the lyrics to "It Is Well With My Soul." There was an article about Spafford and the hymn that was published in the Worcester Daily Spy in November of 1902, and they said this: "In his inutterable sorrow, Mr. Spafford did not chant a dirge to impossible hope. When he reflected that his property was lost in destruction's waste," meaning the Chicago fire, "that his wife was painfully prostrated," somehow she became an invalid as a result of the shipwreck, "and that his four children were buried in the dark waves of the sea, there came from his heart of hearts a song of trust and resignation that has many times encircled the globe. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." When Horatio returned to Chicago with his wife, he said to his friends, "I never felt more like trusting God than I do now." In 1881, Horatio and his wife Anna left their home in Chicago and they moved to Jerusalem, hoping to find peace in the holy city. And they wanted to offer aid to families in distress. And so the Spaffords, along with 16 other people from their church, calling themselves the Overcomers, they journeyed to Jerusalem and they settled in a small house outside the city. They aimed at living a simple New Testament kind of life that we read about in Acts chapter 2. And this group became well known for their acts of generosity and assistance to people in need. And people referred to them simply as the Americans. The group grew, however, with people from other countries, and eventually they purchased a much larger property, which eventually became the American Colony Hotel. It is a 5-star hotel now in Jerusalem to this day, and it houses the Spafford Children's Center, which runs medical, infant welfare, and social work departments for local children. Horatio died of malaria in 1888 in Jerusalem, and his wife followed him to heaven in 1923. They were survived by 2 daughters who were born after the shipwreck. Descendants of the Spafford family still serve on the board of directors of the Children's Center. In his darkest hour, Horatio Spafford turned to the Lord, which is a choice we all have when we are faced with terrible, heart-wrenching events that happen in our lives. We can turn to the Lord, or we can blame him, we can shake our fist at him, we can turn away from him, which many do. Many do, and many never come back to a place of peace with God. Their hearts grow hard, and their hands of service grow still. But that's not what the Spaffords did. In their grief, they continued to trust God and believe God's word found from the beginning of Scripture to the end of Scripture. Pretty much in the middle, we find Psalm 46. Listen to these words. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice and the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. With the help of God, with the strength of God, by the grace of God, we are able to cling to him, friends, even in the worst times of our lives. The deacons are currently reading a book together called Therefore I Have Hope. The author calls the tragic loss of his 3-year-old son, Cam, his worst, with a capital W. And in the very introductory words to the book, he says this: like most people, my mind sometimes wanders to places of doom, to places where my imagination entertains what I perceive to be the worst. In my adult life, I have made this mental journey enough times that my worst had developed with vivid detail. My worst was likely the same as that of many parents, the persistent fear that my child would die. But my worst had a second layer for me. As a youth pastor, I worried that my faith did not possess enough fortitude. God had given me a relatively comfortable life. Any white American male like me, raised in an affluent, stable Christian family, for whom friendships and sports and school and career had come easily, surely would believe that God is good. I feared that if my worst occurred, I would lose my faith. I would turn my back on God and walk away from Christianity, and consequently, my spiritual failure would shatter the faith of hundreds of students to whom I had proclaimed the promises of Christ for over a decade. So he had a two-layered worst fear of losing a child, and then fear of losing his faith in the midst of that. And some of you understand this fear more than others. Some of you have lived through and are living through the loss of a child that you know you will not see again until one day you get to heaven. But it doesn't sound as if Horatio Spafford ever lost his faith. We don't know for sure, but I can picture him falling on his knees when he got the news of this shipwreck and losing his daughters and crying out to God to help him to make it through. And his determined faith is what brought to us this beloved hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul," which helps us so much in our times of trial and trouble. His worst of losing his four daughters had happened, but it seemed as if he didn't have that second layer of fear that the author had. His faith seemed to remain intact because it was well with his soul. He found God to be his refuge and strength, which you can't do if you have turned away from God. In order to know God as your refuge and strength, you have to move towards him. You have to trust him in those moments to draw ever closer to him. And we read at the end of that psalm in verse 10, those words that we all know, "Be still and know that I am God." Be still and know that I am God. And I think sometimes when we are in the darkest places, we refuse to be still. We go and we go and we go in an effort to avoid thinking, to avoid feeling, maybe to avoid connecting with people, to avoid the reality of the pain that we are living in. And when we crash, because we just can't go anymore, we don't allow our minds to rest on the things of God. We don't allow our minds to know anything except the fact that God failed to do what we needed him to do and allowed this pain to come into our lives. It is not well with our soul in those moments because we have allowed bitterness towards God to come into our lives. And I think in many ways, friends, that this is part of what's happening in our country today, that there are a lot of people who are living in bitterness. They seem to hate anyone who doesn't agree with their own political agenda. When I turn on the news, I can barely take it for more than 5 minutes. Just turn it off. There's so much hatred and so much bitterness. Pro-life people hate pro-choice people. Pro-gay people hate people who say that homosexuality is not God's best plan for them. Republicans hate Democrats. Blacks hate whites. Democrats hate our president. I mean, can it be well with our souls when we are allowing this kind of bitterness to fester deep inside of our hearts? And do some of us, I know some do, we live in fear of the worst happening in our country, whatever the worst looks like for you. And so I pray that through this story today that what you've heard about the life of the Spaffords maybe will help you. I pray that you could see in their story that no matter what happens today, or no matter what happens tomorrow, I pray that you have been encouraged to stay the course, to stay the course of faith and hope and love in your life. Because life isn't easy. None of us know what the next hour will bring. Life is not easy, and faith is not easy. But life without faith in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit is far more difficult because it just leaves you empty. Just empty. St. Augustine said this, "You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you." I pray you have found that to be true in your own life. I pray that in times of joy and in times of sorrow, that in times of ease and also in times of hardship, that it is well with your soul, that your trust in God would never fail, no matter what's coming your way, that your heart would find its rest in Jesus Christ, because he knows the trouble that you've seen. He knows the pain that you are bearing even in this very moment. He knows. And he loves you more, as Gary said already. He loves you more than our finite minds can even begin to comprehend. At the end of the book that the deacons are reading, there are a number of statements. And at the very end, the author makes this statement. And I want you to just read it first silently for yourself. And if that describes where you are today, if that describes where you want to be, then I invite you to say this together with me. My life is not over. God has purposes and plans for me in this life until I enter into his paradise. He will use me to love and serve people. He may use my worst as an avenue to comfort others who might share in a similar suffering in the future. God has purpose and meaning in every day of my life until he calls me home. I will live by faith and entrust my life to his service. He will give me joy and hope as I serve him and bear fruit for his kingdom. Amen. As we receive our offering today, we're going to watch a video. This is a song called It Is Well by Matt Redman. There have been thousands of songs that have come from Horatio Spafford's lyrics, It Is Well With My Soul. But I want to read these lyrics for you before we watch the video. Our scars are a sign of grace in our lives. Oh, Father, how you brought us through. When deep were the wounds and dark was the night, the promise of your love you proved. Now every battle still to come, let this be our song, it is well with my soul. Weeping may come, remain for a night, but joy will paint the morning. You're there in the fast, you're there in the feast, your faithfulness will always shine. Now every blessing still to come, let this be our song. It is well with my soul. You lead us through battles, you lead us to blessing, and you make us fruitful in the land of our suffering. I trust your ways, I trust your name. It is well with my soul.
Our scars are a sign of grace in our lives. And Father, how you brought us through. When deep were the wounds and dark was the night, the promise of your love you proved. Now every battle still to come, let this be our song. It is well. Joy will paint the morning sky. You're there in the fast, you're there in the feast. Your faithfulness will always shine. Now every blessing still to come, let this be our song. It is well. Trust your name.
Trust your name.
And it is well. It is well with my soul. You lead us through battles. It is well with my soul. It is well.
It is well
with my soul.
With my soul.
It is well. It is well. It-